Good. Janosch's dream world. My name is Janosch. I'm a big, fat, fabulous bear. Yes, I'm the father of all things. Or is it the stepfather? Yes, that's it. In fact, that's what got me this great job. You see, this is my very own show. Or so the boss says. I can tell any story I like, and to tell the truth, I like them all. In fact, to tell the truth, I know them all. In this one, the little bear and the little tiger go off in search of the land of their dreams. Panama.
Once upon a time, there was a little bear and a little tiger. They lived right next door to the big white tree that puffs smoke.
Isn't it cozy?
Said the little tiger.
We have everything we want here and nothing to be afraid of because we're friends with everybody. Isn't that right, Bear?
You bet,
said the little bear.
I never have to bellow like a bear, and you never have to roar like a tiger, but we don't mind.
Every day, the little bear went fishing down at the river, and the little tiger went into the forest to look for mushrooms. Tigers are all thumbs in the kitchen, so the little bear did most of the cooking.
Would you like your fish with salt and lemon, Mr. Tiger, or would you prefer it with pepper and onion?
Both ways, I think,
said the little tiger.
And in very great quantity.
They hadn't a care in the world. Then one day, an old crate came floating down the river.
Bananas,
said the little bear with delight.
Panama,
he read.
This crate comes from Panama, and Panama smells like bananas. And as of right now, Panama is the land of my dreams.
He went straight home and told the little tiger all about Panama until well past their bedtime.
In Panama,
he said,
everything is much nicer because Panama smells like bananas from top to bottom. Panama is the land of our dreams, Tiger. We must set out for Panama first thing in the morning.
At the crack of dawn,
piped the little tiger.
But I'll only go on one condition, Bear, that my tiger ducky comes too.
The next morning, they got up much earlier than usual.
Since we don't know the way,
said the little bear,
we are going to need a sign to follow.
So they took apart the old crate and built a signpost. Now that they had a sign to follow, the little bear led the way along the riverside. Before long, they met a mouse.
Hello, mouse,
said the little bear.
We're off to Panama. Everything is much better there, and much bigger, too.
It can't be any bigger than my mouse hole,
snorted the mouse.
Hardly worth the effort.
Bah, what do mice know about Panama? Nothing, if not less.
When they met the sly fox, he was just sitting down with a goose to celebrate his birthday.
Excuse me, would you know the way to Panama?
Asked the little bear.
It's somewhere off to the left there,
said the fox without thinking. He really didn't want to be disturbed. A rather sleepy-looking cow agreed with the fox.
Panama must be that way, because the other way, there, is where my barn is, and it's at the end of the world.
They should have known better than to ask a cow for directions, but they pushed on to the left nonetheless. The trouble with always going left is that you end up going around in a circle without even knowing it. Anyhow, before they'd gone much further, they met a hare and a porcupine, bringing in their harvest.
We welcome any travelers with news of the world,
said the hare.
Come home with us and rest your weary feet.
At the home of the hare and the porcupine, all the little bear could talk about was Panama. He and the little tiger had even been allowed to sit on the comfy sofa.
A comfy sofa,
declared the little tiger,
is the most wonderful thing in the world. We're gonna buy one the instant we get to Panama. Then we'll have everything we'll ever need, right?
Right,
agreed the little bear.
Oh, to think,
he sighed,
that soon we'll be sitting on a comfy sofa in Panama, where it smells like bananas all day and all night.
We've never gone further than the end of our field,
said the hare.
This farm was the land of our dreams because it was home and gave us our food. But from now on, our dreamland is Panama. Panama's paradise, right, porcupine?
That night, all four of them had sweet dreams about Panama. The next morning, they continued to their left and came to a broad river.
We must go and look for some wood,
said the little bear. And then he built them a sturdy raft.
I'm honored,
said the little tiger,
to have a friend who knows how to build a raft, especially since I'm not at all fond of swimming.
They launched the raft and floated across to the other side of the river. Feeling quite proud of himself, the little bear took the lead as they set out once more to the left.
Stick with me, tiger, and I'll get us to Panama in no time.
I'm behind you all the way,
chirped the little tiger, and the little bear bore left along the river until they came to a small bridge. Spring floods had torn one of the bridge's planks loose. It was lying in the river.
We'll have to repair the bridge,
said the little tiger.
You take the plank from the bottom, and I'll take the plank from the top. But don't let my tiger ducky fall in.
And so they continued their leftwards journey. Not far from the bridge, they met a crow.
I hope crows are smarter than cows,
said the little bear, getting frustrated. And he asked the crow which road to take.
Ah! Which road?
Asked the crow.
There are hundreds and thousands of roads. Ah!
But only one to Panama,
retorted the little bear.
I know I've seen it somewhere,
said the crow. And he promised to take a look. He flapped his powerful wings and flew higher and higher with the little bear in hot pursuit.
Pull me up, bear,
cried the little tiger.
If I fall, I'll break my tiger ducky.
Now that you're here,
crowed the crow,
see for yourself.
And with a sweep of his wing, he indicated the majestic landscape below.
Oh,
gasped the little tiger.
It's so beautiful, isn't it, bear?
More beautiful than anything I've ever seen in my whole entire life,
agreed the little bear. Of course, what they were seeing was nothing new, just the river and the countryside. But they had never seen it from so high up before.
Oh, I think I see Panama,
cried the little tiger.
Come on! Let's go! Bear, when we get to Panama, let's find a big white tree that puffs smoke and build a cozy little house right next door.
They hadn't searched for very long when, lo and behold, they came across a signpost lying in the grass.
See what it says, tiger?
Let's see. Paraguay.
Wrong.
Pancakes.
No, you dunderhead. Panama. Panama. Tiger, we're in Panama, the land of our dreams.
And they danced and cheered, convinced they had reached Panama at last. A little further on, they came to an old house with a white chimney.
Oh, Tiger, a beautiful little house, and it's right next door to a big white tree. Oh, we'll have it puffing smoke in no time. Oh, doesn't it look cozy, Tiger?
Bubbled the little bear.
Let's take a look.
The wind and the rain had done their work so thoroughly that they didn't even recognize their own home. With no one to tend them, the trees and bushes had grown much bigger.
Everything is bigger here,
cried the little tiger.
Panama is wonderful. I love it already.
They went to work fixing up the house. Together, they patched the roof, built a table and two chairs, and repainted the beds. Then they weeded the garden and planted a whole new assortment of flowers and plants. The little bear went fishing. The little tiger gathered mushrooms. And to top it all off, they went out and bought the comfiest, comfy sofa they could lay their hands on. Now the little house in the wood was the coziest in all creation again.
Oh, Tiger,
sighed the little bear happily.
Panama is everything we hoped it would be, isn't it?
Yes,
agreed the little tiger.
It's the land of our dreams, and we'll never leave it ever again.
Do you think all that traveling was worth it? Do you think they should have just stayed home in the first place? Oh, no, they'd never have met the fox or the crow. In fact, they'd never have met the hare and the porcupine. And if they hadn't met them, they'd never have known the deep, blissful tranquility of a truly comfy, comfy sofa.
Oh, nice. Oh, nice, huh? Huh? Oh, my cue. He buzzed by to remind me that my next story has to do with aviation, flight. In fact, it's about a man named Popov, who can fly in the sky without wings, without a plane. Yeah.
Far off in the golden land of margarine, nestled against the edge of a great forest, sits a humble little cottage. It's so old that the rafters creak, even though the roof isn't heavy. In fact, it's only made of straw. On sunny days, the plaster cracks and falls, and the windows are black with soot. An old man lives here. His name is Popov. In the olden days, Popov was as strong as two grizzly bears. As he grew older, his strength diminished, but he was still crafty as a fox and a friend to all animals everywhere. He could even speak to them in their own languages and was often called upon to act as an interpreter. In this case, some bees would like to send a message to Popov's star boarder, a saffron-throated Prululu.
Pre-hoo-hoo-hoo, roo-too-too-too, Prululu.
Which was simply to say, wake up, sleepyhead. The lilacs have opened down by the stream that runs through the valley. And the last one there is a slippery slug. The little Prululu had been Popov's closest friend for years. In fact, he was the one who taught Popov how to fly. Oh, yes, and I'll tell you the story of how that came about right now. One evening, Popov was lying down on his bed of straw. He had already pulled off his boots. His pants were hanging on a nail in the roof beam, and the window was open. Suddenly, someone with a very sharp beak tapped him on the shoulder.
Hey, you.
Who?
You.
Me?
Yes, you.
Oh, it's you.
It was a little Prululu. Popov had watched him build his nest under the eaves of his cottage, but as yet the little bird hadn't introduced himself.
Come with me.
Who? Where?
You. Up there, to the castle.
What castle?
The one up there in the sky.
Popov knew about the castle in the sky, all right. On sunny summer days, he'd glance up and catch a fleeting glimpse of a magnificent castle floating in the blue.
But it's up in the air,
retorted old Popov.
And I can't fly.
Fly? Fly? There's nothing to flying. Anyone can fly once they've learned how. Step outside.
And so, the little Pululu taught him how to fly. Popov got up on the bench beside his front door.
Scrunch up your shoulders. Tilt your head to the right for takeoff. Now blink your eyes. Elbows at your sides. And make your fingertips go flippity-flap.
His feet lifted gently off the bench. And slowly, he began to rise.
Lift your elbows a little. You're too stiff.
He made a left turn, a little clumsily, but not bad for an old man. And at a sensible speed, they floated along above the treetops, the Prululu in the lead and Popov close behind. The little Prululu landed softly on a treetop and waited for Popov to join him. Popov hovered over the branch.
Relax your shoulders. Good. Rest your palms on the wind and let your body sink.
Popov did as he was told and descended slowly to touch down gently on the branch beside the little Prululu. Being barefoot, he was able to get a firm grip on the branch with his toes, which of course is why birds never wear shoes. Above them gleamed the castle in the sky.
They're lighting the candles.
As the Prululu took off, he signaled to Popov with his wing.
Come, come.
It was the perfect time of day for flying. No air pockets or sudden gusts of wind. Just a warm, steady updraft that wafted Popov up, up towards the castle. They were there in no time. As is the rule with all castles in the sky, the walls were purest crystal, so they could see right into the candle-lit room. Old Popov's head began to swim. It wasn't all the gold and silver or the number of servants that muddled his brain. It was the 12 princesses that sat around the table. The first was beautiful. The second was more so. And the third even more so. And on it went around the table, each more beautiful than the last. And the more he looked, the more beautiful they became. And the more beautiful they became, the more he looked. Poor Popov was in another world. Meantime, a servant had spotted Popov and his little companion. He approached the old king, who was sitting a little aside from his daughters, on a magnificent throne made of solid gold.
There are two gentlemen perched on the windowsill, sire. Is there any message? Tell them to come in. Seat them next to my daughters. What do they look like? One is quite small, with a long nose. And the other is quite large, with a very nice mustache. Seat the small gentleman beside me, eh? And the large one next to Pia. And if they wish, they can marry them tomorrow. One Mia, and the other Pia.
But alas, they heard no more. Popov was so overwhelmed, he tumbled backwards right off the ledge. He dropped like a stone. His loyal friend, the Prululu, dove after him instantly and tried to slow his descent as he cried,
"Spread your arms, Popov. You must fly. Fly!"
As soon as Popov spread his arms and rested his palms on the wind, he began to glide to a halt, and before long, he came to rest on a beech tree, safe and sound.
He called us gentlemen, gentlemen,
sighed the Prululu.
Can you believe it? Oh, this is the happiest day of my life, it truly is.
Do you think they noticed?
Groaned Popov.
What? What?
That I wasn't wearing any pants.
He called us gentlemen, gentlemen,
sighed the Prululu once more.
I've never had a king call me a gentleman before. A real king.
No pants,
wailed Popov.
I can't get married in my nightshirt. But in the morning, I'll fly back to the castle, all dressed first thing.
Being called a gentleman tastes better than three fat, juicy worms right after a thunderstorm.
Did you like Mia?
Like her? Of course. But how can I marry her? I already have a wife. She lives with me in the nest.
And then they flew home. The Prululu went straight to his nest. And Popov went straight to bed. And he dreamed of the beautiful Mia. But alas, he never saw her again. For the next morning, the castle had vanished. But still, he had learned how to fly.
Sometimes I say to myself, but then sometimes I also think yes. Yes. And then again, I think, no.
Anna Strokoff got up every morning at 6:30 and waited for the postman's car to come. And when Mr. Neugebauer, the postman, got out of his car with his enormous mail bag, Anna Strokoff went to meet him and asked,
"Oh, have you got a letter addressed to a Mr. Hannes Strokoff? That's me, on Übersee Street."
Mr. Neugebauer looked carefully in his big mail bag, checking all the letters.
"No, I'm very sorry."
This happened every day. On the 12th day, Hannes Strokoff was so excited he could hardly sleep. He got up at the first sign of dawn and went out into the street, shivering in the cold. When he saw the mailman's car coming, he ran to meet it. Mr. Neugebauer looked in his mailbag and read,
"No postage due." "Ah, yes, Hannes Strokoff. You're very welcome."
For Hannes Strokoff, it was the most wonderful day of his life. The letter had two stamps on it, beautiful and from far away. He squeezed the letter gently. He felt something in it. He carried it very carefully so it wouldn't get broken. He knew he had to open it very cautiously so nothing would fall out. Inside, he found a little bag and a letter.
"My dear Hannes, enclosed please find a little sack containing a magic powder. It was my friend, the medicine man, whose life I once saved, who gave it to me in case of emergency. And I think you need it more than I do. Follow the instructions carefully. Write to me soon. I'm in a hurry. I have to go hunting wolves and smoke the pipe of peace. Love, your Uncle Jonas."
Hannes always knew he could count on his Uncle Jonas. Hannes Strokoff read the instructions for use.
"Empty out the powder, being careful not to lose a single grain, and put it in a shallow glass dish. When there's a full moon, place the dish on the windowsill in the moonlight and set fire to it. But before striking the match, stroke it three times with an owl's feather, preferably from left to right. Sometime during the night, you must dream of a magic word having more than seven syllables. The next morning, the invisible Indian will be beside you. He is your friend. You can talk with him about anything, ask him anything. He'll always be with you. You'll never again be alone. No one else will be able to see him. Only don't let him freeze."
That day, every minute seemed like a year. For Hannes Strokoff, it was the longest day of his life. In his class at school, Professor Birkenreisig gave him 3 zeros, and he was scolded for not paying attention and letting his mind wander. But finally, evening came. Hannes could see the full moon from his window. He read the instructions again to be sure he knew them. Read them slowly, word by word. Because when you're dealing with the magic powder, you have to get everything right.
Pour the magic powder into a glass dish. Stroke a match 3 times from left to right with a feather from an owl. Light it. Put it by the window in the moonlight. The next morning, the invisible Indian will be there with you. He'll be your friend.
Hannes didn't want to sleep that night because he wanted to see the Indian when he appeared. He wanted to see the invisible Indian. However, his eyes got heavy and he fell asleep. And a good thing he did, because he had to dream the magic word. As the instructions said, a magic word with more than 7 syllables. Hannes Strokoff dreamt of the longest, most beautiful word he could think of.
Knix, Knex, Knobel, Lax, Faxer, Brax.
When he woke up the next morning, Hannes looked at the window. He could hardly believe his eyes. Right there in the window was a gigantic, magnificent Indian with a brown face.
Oh, oh!
Hannes Strokoff got out of bed, shook hands with him, and they became friends. The Indian's name was Ibu Hubu. At first, Hannes Strokoff was worried. What if the Indian was not really invisible? Or even if he could be seen by others, just a little bit? What would his mother think? That had to be considered. At breakfast, the two friends sat down side by side. Hannes Strokoff immediately kept the chair right beside him for Ibu Hubu. His mother wanted to push the chair in. And that was when Hannes knew that Ibu Hubu was really invisible. His mother hadn't seen him, or she wouldn't have tried to push the chair in. Hannes saved a slice of bread and passed it to Ibu Hubu.
Here, a slice of bread with marmalade on it.
But Ibu Hubu shook his head. No.
We invisible beings never eat marmalade. We never eat anything. That's the way it is.
On the way to school, Hannes walked in front, and Ibu Hubu just behind. Maybe he doesn't know the way very well yet, thought Hannes. He's new here. I'll lead the way. He watched the other people, passing them. They didn't notice anything unusual. They just went their way. Hannes was very conscious of his friend walking behind him. And even without looking at him, he got a feeling of strength from him. He took big steps like a giant. He could feel his muscles getting harder and his shoulders getting broader. And he was sure that nothing in the world could frighten him.
Duck your head here,
Hannes said on the way into the school. Ibu Hubu was several centimeters taller than the door.
An Indian never ducks his head,
said Ibu Hubu. and he kept his head up. Tall as a tree, proud as an eagle, and went right through the wall. Hannah Strokoff crossed the classroom, went down the aisle to get to his desk, the last at the back, taking big strides. And what happened? Nobody tried to trip him. They didn't shoot him with pea shooters. No balls of paper. They didn't even splash ink on him. Only Epi Schneider whispered,
"Chicken."
Hannes got up, walked up to him and said,
"What? No, nothing. I didn't say anything. It must have been somebody else. I didn't say anything. That's what I thought,"
said Hannes Strokoff. Ibu Hubu stayed just behind his desk. Hannes looked at him. He could see that Ibu Hubu had a lot of courage. And that gave Hannes courage, too. For the first hour, they did arithmetic. Ibu Hubu stood right beside Professor Birkenreisig. The Indian was so tall. The teacher looked small. Nobody in the classroom could see him. Except Hannes, of course. Not even the professor. Now Hannes was absolutely certain Ibu Hubu was really invisible.
Strokoff?
Here.
And suddenly Hannes wasn't afraid anymore. He stood up straight as a soldier and spoke out clearly.
4 and 2 times 7 minus 3 makes?
Asked Birkenreisig.
39.
Birkenreisig looked over his glasses. Well, can this really be Strokoff, he thought. But he didn't say anything. He got his notebook out of his pocket and wrote a very high mark in it. The questions weren't easy, and no one answered as quickly as Hannes. And it was not because Ibu Hubu was whispering the answers to him. Honest, he really wasn't. It was just that Hannes suddenly knew how to count, when he wasn't nervous. He discovered he knew quite a lot. During recess, no one made fun of him. They stood around in little groups of 5 or 6.
"Come and join us, Strokoff,"
said one of them. But Hannes stayed leaning on the fence close to his friend. From there, they could see outside. Hannes Strokoff understood that an Indian needed to have wide open spaces around him. Ibu Hubu looked into the distance. And Hannes Strokoff looked through a crack in the fence. Everything was perfect. After recess came the painting class.
"Now, students,"
said Birkenreisig,
"Easter is just 2 days away, as you know. And for one last time this year, we'll paint Easter eggs. It is a joyful time, so you should use joyful colors. And you have many colors to work with, so use them all. Go ahead."
Hannes Strokoff wanted his Indian friend to see how well he could paint. So he put all the colors he had on one egg. And the colors all became gray, brown, and black.
"See that?"
said Hannes.
"The colors canceled each other. Everything I do goes wrong. That's what I was telling you when I asked for help from you and Uncle Jonas. Everything I do is wrong. Every brush stroke is wrong,"
whispered Hannes.
"Nothing is wrong. There is no such thing as wrong,"
said his Indian friend.
"Think about it, Hannes. If you do the best you can, then it is right. If it is different, then you have created something that is new. Something that has never been done before. And that means that everything you paint is right. Believe me, it's true."
Anna Strokoff thought about what he had said and knew it was true. Anna Strokoff felt as if there were flowers blooming all around him. He didn't even hear the recess bell. He was so busy painting his eggs. What has come over Strokoff all of a sudden? Thought everybody. He used to be the dumbest one in the whole class, and now he knows how to paint.
Take a look at that,
said Professor Bergen-Reisig.
That is the way to do it. Strokoff knows exactly how to paint Easter eggs. Study this carefully, and we'll keep it here to look at next year.
And the professor wrote an even higher mark beside Hannes Strokoff's name. Hannes had suddenly become the best Easter egg painter in the whole school. When he went out in the schoolyard, they all made way for him. That night, when Hannes Strokoff went to bed, he lay down beside his pillow, leaving the place on the pillow for his friend, so he'd be comfortable. Buddy Boo-Hoo-Boo said,
Indians never sleep in soft beds. The prairie is cold and hard. That is what Indians are used to.
He settled himself down on the floor and stayed on guard. He looked out the window all night long, contemplating the stars. And Hannes Strokoff slept like a log. He wasn't afraid of anything. And so the time went by. After only 4 weeks, in the little notebook of Professor Bergen-Reisig, there were 5 red stars and 2 gold ones for Hannes Strokoff. He was now only the 5th worst in the class. He moved forward 3 desks. He would have preferred to stay in the last desk because it was right next to the window. And from there, Ibu-Hubu could look at the great outdoors. However, Ibu-Hubu didn't mind the wall at all. He had such a piercing gaze, he could look into the distance right through the wall. After Indian summer came the autumn. And winter was next. One morning, there was frost on the grass. 2 days later, a thin coat of ice appeared on the water. It was freezing weather. And Hannes Strokoff noticed that he couldn't see his friend as clearly as before. Mind you, he knew he was still there, but his image seemed to be blurring a bit. The next morning, Ibu-Hubu had gone. The room was empty. He had just disappeared. Hannes looked everywhere, but he couldn't find his friend. It was a disaster, the worst day of Hannes Strokoff's life. desperation, he wrote a letter to his Uncle Jonas.
Dear Uncle Jonas, I don't know what to do. Ibu Hubu suddenly disappeared. He didn't say he was going to leave. And we didn't have an argument or anything. I am very sad, Uncle Jonas. Please write to me quickly by airmail or a special messenger and tell me what I must do. Your loving Hannes.
And his letter was so full of sadness that Uncle Jonas answered his nephew immediately.
Hannes, my dear boy,
wrote Uncle Jonas,
there's nothing to worry about because Ibu Hubu has not really left you. You have forgotten what the instructions said. Don't let him freeze. Winter came and Ibu Hubu got cold and had to leave. But it really doesn't matter. You can do everything by yourself now. You can paint Easter eggs. You can track down animals. And you understand the secret languages. Please write again if you're in trouble. Your loving Uncle Jonas.
What he said was true. Hannes knew how to paint Easter eggs. He knew how to track down animals. And he understood secret languages. No one made fun of him at school because he had become much stronger. And he knew for sure Ibu Hubu had not left him completely. Uncle Jonas had said so. And so everything turned out just fine.
I think I'd better... No, yes. No.